Hey everybody, welcome to VK Live. It is Tuesday.
It is Tuesday, all day.
Yeah, we're getting there. I'm Brian Vines.
And I'm Aaron Watkins, very, very happy to be here. I don't know if you had a chance to check it out on the interwebs or in your daily news today, but I did want to give a special VK Live shout out and props and respect to Joey Resto. If you haven't had a chance to see it, his video has gone on YouTube, garnered over 300,000.
The video,
clips.
You know, it seemed pretty self-explanatory, so I didn't click on it, but, like, he gave the shirt off his back.
Literally gave the shirt off his back to a homeless man that he did not know while he was on a Brooklyn-bound A-train.
Yeah, so we got some Camera 5 action, Doctor. And it's, like, in the midst of all of this stuff we're hearing about de Blasio and Cuomo.
Absolutely.
Going back and forth about homelessness and when to yank people off the street, when temperatures dip, it's nice to see just that simple act of human kindness.
Of like kindness and charity and generosity.
And it's like biblical.
It is.
Shirt off
on a Tuesday.
Kind of stuff.
Well, yeah.
All right.
So
God bless you.
Congratulations, Joey.
Joey.
We appreciate you.
All right. Well, after the San Bernardino shootings, called the worst terrorist attack on American soil since 9/11, in a bid to deter future attacks, the U.S. government has implemented a wave of restrictions aimed at making it harder for certain foreign nationals to travel here freely. Today, we'll look at the impact of some of those measures, in particular the ones affecting the visa waiver program, and even more specifically for people who have dual citizenship with the four countries of Iraq, Syria, Sudan, or Iran.
Yes. And next Monday, of course, is MLK Day. And as it has for every year since 1985, the Central Brooklyn Martin Luther King Commission will give out awards to Brooklyn children who compete in civil rights-related essays, poetry, and art. We'll hear all about it from one of the sons of the late Congressman Major Owens, who began this tradition, a former winner of the competition who now works for the organization, and from State Assemblyman Walter Mosley, who will be calling in from Albany.
All right, sounds good. Well, not too long ago, a lot of folks came to Brick House for one of our Stoop Series events, even though, or maybe because, the subject of the night was hair. Personal stories were shared, a barber gave someone a haircut live, and a sketch comedy troupe sang funny songs about dated styles. But one of the real highlights was listening to the writer and TV host Francesca Ramsey. Now, you might know her from her viral video hit, Stuff White Girls Say to Black Girls. But coming up, we'll put you right in the middle of that audience.
Exactly where you want to be. Well, the African-American experience, natural hair aside, covers a lot of territory, but much of it is still not being captured by filmmakers. Or if they are putting it on film, it's not so easy for their work to necessarily find an audience. Mm-hmm. In Bed-Stuy, a small organization called the Luminal Theater wants to change that, and we'll find out how it's trying to find a permanent home. But before all that, what the changes to the visa waiver program mean if you have family who want to come visit you from certain countries. That's in just a moment.
Did you ever see when the circus came to town, they'd leave mystery? When they took the tent down, and since heaven breathed a faded smile of clown. Oh, I think it's time to go right this way, please. Leave your money at the door. If it's hope you need, they got all of that more for a small eating peanuts off the floor.
All right. right. So before we get into today's A segment, we thought we'd share a little bit of a cheat sheet, a primer, if you will, to bring you up to speed on the visa waiver program. Now, the visa waiver program started here in the United States in 1986. Currently, there are about 38 countries on the list. Now, initially, it was designed to sort of smooth the way for folks who wanted to come and do some tourism or a quick little business trip and stay in the United States for up to 90 days. Now, the thing is, you wouldn't have to apply for a visa if you're one of these 38 member countries. You could just sort of slip in and slip out. And we have reciprocity with those other nations. There are about 20 million people a year who come here using the visa program. The number one country is the UK, a longtime ally, of course. Japan is the second, with about 4 million people behind the UK's 4.1 million people. And Germany rounds out the top three, sending about 2 million people on the visa waiver program here a year. Now, the program brings about 20 million people in and supplies about $190 billion and supports 1 million jobs here in the U.S. And in 2014, there were $74 billion directly tied to that tourism from folks from those 38 countries. Now, a new bill that became a law that was introduced in December of last year, December 18th to be exact, H.R. 158, was introduced after the Paris and San Bernardino shootings. Now, what differentiates this bill is somewhere tucked in a spending bill that was designed to keep our government funded through September of this year, this question about citizenship and four specific countries came up, those being Iraq, Syria, Sudan, and Iran. Now, it excludes anyone who's been to those countries since 2011 from the quick visa waiver program. And the real kicker is, if you have dual citizenship, that means if you hold a country from a passport from any of those four countries, you also don't qualify for that citizenship for the waiver program, and you have to regularly get into the queue that any person from a non-member company would. It passed the House with 407 votes in favor, and only 19 people stood up and said no. 10 days later, President Obama signed the law. Well, Aaron is going to introduce our guests who are going to bring us a little bit more insight into the issue, and he's with them now.
Joining us now to give us more details on this complex issue is Murtaza Hussain, a journalist with The Intercept, who recently wrote about the discriminatory nature of the bill. Welcome to BK Live.
Thanks for having me.
And we're also pleased to meet Kayvon Afshari, the Brooklyn-based Director of Communications for the American Iranian Council, a think tank dedicated to improving U.S.-Iran relations since 1990. And great to have you both here,
gentlemen. Glad to be here.
Okay. Now, Brian gave us a brief breakdown of H.R. 158, but Murtaza, can you give us an idea of what the impact might be here and abroad?
Well, let's take a hypothetical situation. Say you're a person of Iranian descent, or say Sudanese descent, or Syrian or Iraqi descent, and you want to travel to Europe. Now, you're an American born, you've lived your whole life in the United States, and you're a passport holder. Theoretically, now, under the ramifications of this bill, Europe could decline to give you visa-free travel like any other American citizen. Because with H.R. 158, European citizens have lost that right to travel if they're of descent of those countries. And that triggers reciprocity as part of the visa waiver provisions. So theoretically, you could be creating a class of dual citizenship, whereas people from certain countries, if their parents are from those countries, they'll be a lower class of citizen. And if you want to travel to Europe or other places, you'll be denied the same rights that other Americans have.
So, Kayvon, we woke up to news about a terrorist attack in Turkey that people are blaming on a Syrian national. Syria is one of these four countries. So weighing that news against these concerns here in America about people having free reign versus safety, how do you think that's going to affect the public sentiment on this bill?
Yeah, well, I think that, I mean, there certainly are steps that they're taking with this ostensible goal of increasing national security. But what confuses me by this bill is the inclusion of Iran in this law. It doesn't really make sense, right? And by doing so, it manages to be both thoroughly discriminatory and, I would argue, completely inefficacious as well. That is to say, it will not increase national security one iota. It's discriminatory because there are many, like thousands and thousands of people who travel to Iran. I was just there a few months ago, and there are German, Italian, Italian, French, British tourists all over Esfahan and other beautiful sites that people go to Iran to see tourism and historical sites. None of them are going and committing terrorism afterwards. And it's also inefficacious to the extent that there's no phenomenon of people going to Iran and becoming radicalized and consequently committing acts of terrorism in the West. That's just not a phenomenon that's taking place. So you're discriminating and you're not increasing national security at all by including Iran in this bill, in this law, excuse me. The reason that Iran was included was because they list the states that are on the state sponsors of terrorism list, which Iran has been on since 1986 for its support of Hezbollah. So that makes me think that the putative goal of increasing national security isn't really the driving factor behind including Iran. It's more about the relationship between the United States and Iran and putting increasing pressure on Iran, which, you know, ever since the nuclear accord, the JCPOA, the trajectory has been arguably more positive on U.S.-Iran relations.
So you're not against the law. You just don't want Iran
I am against the law. But I also understand that, you know, there are some steps that could be, like, if someone were to travel to a specific geographical location that is known to be an ISIS training camp, right? I mean, I think most people would reasonably say that that person who traveled there needs to go through extra security. That's a reasonable step. So in this broad debate between civil liberties and national security, I am not on the extreme of either of those sides. I'm trying to think about what a smart policy that limits discrimination and manages to provide, you know, a reasonable amount of national security. It will probably never be perfect, sadly. So, you know, there are some reasonable aspects to it. So if you go to the, you know, specific training camp, yeah, naturally, you know, you should face extra security. And unfortunately, you know, through many factors, many unfortunate causes, there is a phenomenon of radicalization taking place at ISIS training camps. So in certain parts of Syria and Iraq, that is taking place. But the inclusion of Iran just, it doesn't fit that bill at all.
You know, Mataz, I have to ask you, how will this affect humanitarian efforts? Because so many of these places, you know, are places of crisis. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there's refugees in Syria, but, you know, how does this affect humanitarian efforts from a global perspective?
So one of the most troubling aspects of the bill is the fact that not only does it affect national origins, it affects people who, as mentioned, travel to these zones and without discrimination. So if you're a journalist, an aid worker, someone else involved in humanitarian work in those regions, you are also affected and you will lose your visa-free right to travel. So consequently, it's a big break on those sort of individuals who are trying to ameliorate the situation there and try to bring it to some reasonable conclusion. Furthermore, there's an aspect which Kayvon alluded to that it seems this bill has been targeted to a moment of undermining U.S. and Iranian relations because the ramifications of the bill also affect the Iran nuclear deal potentially. So hypothetically again, say you're a British or a Japanese businessman and you want to travel to Iran to take advantage of the newly opened economic environment. By doing so, you forfeit your right to travel to the United States later on visa-free. So it acts as an effective economic sanction against Iran without actually being called one. And that's what makes it very troubling. And the fact that, you know, Syria and Iraq, we could disagree, but it's reasonable, I think, to say that there are fears and people traveling to ISIS territory, we need to stop that. But the inclusion of Iran is totally gratuitous and baffling in some ways.
And I just want to dovetail off that also. I mean, there is a specific clause in the JCPOA, the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, that is the nuclear accord that they adopted. That it's Article 29 that says, I'm paraphrasing, but essentially that, you know, the P5 plus one powers shall make no policies that are intended to directly adversely affect the normalization of trade with Iran. Yeah. And it's arguable that this is a violation. I mean, there is an argument there. I don't want to say that for sure it is, because I think that, you know, the U.S. could find some loophole there. But, I mean, it certainly is against the spirit of the JCPOA to enact
this.
Well,
speaking of spirit, we've seen the letter that John Kerry wrote, and maybe there might be some backpedaling there to say, okay, we want to normalize relations, but we're going to stick it to you with the visa thing. So I just wanted to know, like, Maz, you're out, and you take the temperature of just everyday folks on these issues as well. Are everyday Americans as concerned as the government would lead us to believe about people who come from Iran?
I think Iran, not so much.
Or do we even know? Like, are we happy to be dumb and they're all from over there?
You know, fears of terrorism are so overblown. Like you said, they tend to not be thoroughly defined or nuanced or, you know, specific. And unfortunately, people get lumped all over there. But it's incumbent upon people in government whose job is to, you know, implement responsible and effective policies, mm-hmm. that they should not succumb to the same sort of tendencies. And I really think that the inclusion of Iran, mm-hmm. it has to be some sort of, if not malicious, then a cynical attempt to undermine these relations which are on the uptick. And I think it bodes very poorly because if Obama's going to leave in the next year or so, the nuclear deal was his one of his legacies of his administration, especially if another government comes in which is hostile to his legacy, say a Republican government. This could be a first indicator of measures they'll take to undermine that deal and potentially put us back on the path to conflict with Iran after so much time and energy had been spent to divert us from the potentially disastrous course.
So if Iran wasn't one of the four, would we be having this conversation?
That's a good question. I think that, you know, there would still be a conversation to be had, but it would be one, it would be a very kind of nuanced conversation, and arguments, good arguments could be made on both sides. And we'd be having certainly a very different conversation, I would say.
Do you think the fact that we're sort of in a presidential year and there's a lot of rhetoric sort of being just, you know, in vitriol just being, you know, spewed all over our television, polarizing though that it is, does that sort of affect this conversation and to the point of it affecting Congress?
Absolutely. And despite that, though, this bill is so incendiary in its details.
We keep calling it a bill, it's a law now, unfortunately. Well, I do the same thing, so.
It's not
under the law.
I have to say. So essentially, they had to slip this in an omnibus bill. So even the fact that, like you said, correctly noted, there's so much hysteria and hyperbole, the details are so inflammatory and so deleterious to, you know, normal policymaking that they had to slide it in at the last moment. And I think even, you know, Obama and John Kerry and others, when they realized what's going to happen, there was alarm and there was an attempt to do damage control, because I think that, you know, it really did cross the line. This, for that reason, they had to do it in a way which was a bit sneakier and more secretive than usual.
So are we safer, Kayvon, for having this law?
No, absolutely not. Totally inefficacious. Doesn't increase national security. Well, I mean, again, like going back to like specific geographical locations where people may travel, yes, to that extent. But in terms of the addition of Iran to it, not at all. But I wanted to continue on what you were talking about with kind of the rhetoric that's taking place right now. And I mean, there certainly is a kind of anti-Muslim, I would just say, plainly speaking, an anti-Brown kind of current in American politics, unfortunately, right now. And there's many reasons for that. But I also, I want to say, in terms of this bill, you know, people will sometimes say, well, all you have to do is apply for a visa, right? It's a minor inconvenience. But to me, the reason I'm so affronted by this is not about that inconvenience. I mean, it is true. If the EU reciprocates and my friends and I want to go—
It's just one more thing to do before your trip.
Right. And if my friends and I want to go on a Euro trip, I would be the only one of them, as an American citizen, in fact, who would have to apply for a visa. That's an inconvenience. But it's really not just about the inconvenience. It's about the implication of this. And the implication of it is that by being an Iranian-American dual citizen, someone who has traveled to Iran, that I may perhaps be a terrorist. That's the reason that it's such an affront to civil rights and to equal rights, and why I'm passionately against this.
So just to backtrack for a second, the thing that's mind-boggling to me is the fact, like you said, it was in an omnibus thing. Mm. Like, they say, you know what, if you want to keep the lights on in the government through September of this year, just sign yes to this thing. So it just makes you wonder how many layers of things are going to come back to bite us in the ass that we voted for.
It's just anti-democratic.
Absolutely.
It's anti-democratic.
To keep the lights on.
Absolutely. It's deeply, deeply troubling that that's the way that they had to broach the subject.
Yeah.
And I think that, unfortunately, the political rhetoric of certain individuals, Donald Trump only being the most bombastic of them.
Right. We don't do that.
The he who shall not be named. He is only the most bombastic and sort of loud of those people engaging this rhetoric. But across the spectrum, people are saying things like Chris Christie said we need to ban all Syrian refugees, including up to and including orphans. Yeah. Jeb Bush, Ted Cruz, and others have echoed similar sentiments. And now you're seeing government actually legislating those ideas or beginning to legislate those ideas. And in 2016, we're anticipating a raft of further measures. Mm-hmm. We don't know the specifics yet, but there are indications that there are going to be further discriminatory immigration and migration laws proposed in the United States. And it's going to be a really tough battle because we've had experiences like this before in the United States, in the Asian exclusion laws, laws targeting refugees from Europe during World War II. And we're going through the same cycle once more, and it's important to be tenacious and to be on guard for the same sort of demagogues and irresponsible populists that we've seen in the past.
So in our last 30 seconds, I'm going to ask you each about your opinion of when the rubber is really going to meet the road on this, when we're actually going to see impact and ramifications as Americans.
I think it comes down really to whether they actually implement it or not. Mm-hmm. And there are laws that sometimes are in the books but just don't get implemented. And this, in fact, especially the dual national clause, will be very difficult to implement. It'll be very hard to just, you know, for Border Patrol to just determine if somebody is also an Iranian citizen. Yeah. So it may not actually be implemented. The clause about people who have traveled to those four countries will certainly be easier to implement because you will likely see it on their passport. Yeah. So it may not actually, again, be fully implemented and have, you know, the horrible consequences. But to me, again, it's really more about the precedent that it's setting and the implication behind this law. So that's why I object to
it.
I really second the part about the precedent because it does create the possibility of a tiered citizenship effectively, and that can be a very dangerous road to go down. I'm also very concerned about the nuclear deal because the Iranian government has taken note of the fact that this has happened, and the position of Iranian hardliners who oppose the deal has always been the United States is going to impose sanctions anyway. So you can negotiate this deal, but they'll put the sanctions back on. And any indication that that could be happening is very troubling to people on both sides who are trying to find a reasonable solution. And it empowers the people who want to take the deal, both in Iran and the United States. And that's something which I'd hope doesn't come to pass, but it's something which it's a poor leading indicator on that front.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for talking about it, too. We appreciate Brick TV taking a platform to talk about this stuff. That's great.
I urge you, employ you to read Maz's article on The Intercept about it. It's enlightening.
Oh, thank you.
Great article.
Thank you.
Great article.
Appreciate
thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Well, unlike my co-host here, I deal with the hair on my head with some shaving cream and a razor. But if you do have enough of it to bother with, it can be a very big deal how you deal with it. And that was the theme of our Stoop Series event, which brought the very funny Francesca Ramsey to our stoop. Take a look.
So, when I was in middle school, I was about 14 years old, there was one thing that I wanted more than anything in the world, more than perfectly symmetrical breast. Shout out to the little boob. Whatever, we all have one. And I wore my hair down so you don't know which one it is. The thing I also wanted more than my period, because when you're like a little girl, you actually want your period and not in that like, where the f*** is my period sort of way, which happens still. More one of those, someday I'll get my period and I'll run through fields like I'm in a tampon commercial. More than all of those things, what I wanted was a perm. And it's funny because when you say the word perm, there's like two different interpretations. For white people, they think like big, curly, fried, Sarah Jessica Parker, pre-flat iron, right? But for black girls, we think kind of the exact opposite, like straight, limp, and kind of fried, right? Because like when that creamy crack hits your scalp, kind of smells like onion rings a little bit. But the perm is also known by a more sinister name, the relaxer. Doesn't that sound like a horror movie? Your curls are in danger, the relaxer is coming for you. Right? Like I could imagine like a I Know What You Did Last Summer style film with like a bunch of natural hair gurus that are being stalked by the relaxer. He like poisons their shea butter at night and then he like makes them get a really expensive sew-in that's like not blended really well and like the edges are all kind of out and they're like, no, the relaxer got me. Listen, we don't need any more f-ing Steve Jobs films. Someone make the relaxer. Like three movies about Steve Jobs? Really, three? Make the relaxer. Start a Kickstarter, someone. The other thing that kind of bothers me about the name relaxer is it's kind of low-key racist, right? Like, hello, angry black woman stereotype. Like, the box might have well have just said, like, listen up, Negress, your hair is too angry and loud!
You need to relax every 4 to 6 weeks.
You're like, okay, yes. I just want the job so bad. I really want the job. Even with all of those mixed messages, I still really wanted one. And so I begged my mom, because my mom had one. The only other black girl in my class had one. My cousins had one. And at 14, my mom said I could finally get a relaxer. And I knew, before she even said yes, what brand I wanted. I wanted just for me. The Kitty Perm with the amazing theme song. I want style, body and shine, a look that's totally all mine. Hair so soft, silky and free. I want something that's just for me. Come on, just for me. No lie, relaxer, conditioning cream. Come on, just for me. For combing and styling, that's worry free. Oh my God. You guys, that was such a freaking good theme song. And you knew it was for black people because there was a rap, right? It's not a product for black people, there's not a rap, right? So I really, really wanted just for me. And here's the thing, if the theme song did not sell you on the product, the promise of it being a no-lie product was supposed to help you. And no-lie means that there's like some chemical that's not in there that's not gonna burn your scalp, which ironically is a lie. It's not true. Two words, scalp scabs, they're a real thing. I've had them, they are a real thing. The other thing is there's nothing about relaxed hair, in my experience, that's worry-free. Not one freaking thing. Like when it rains during your soccer game, lots of worry. You can't get that wet because then you have to like blow dry it and wrap it and set it. You can't do that. Or what about, you know, when you get invited to a pool party? No, that's not fun either. I mean, it's bad enough that I had a pot belly in middle school and I had to wear a one piece where all my friends wore two pieces. And then I also had to wear like a plastic grandma cap. I was worried. I was full of worry. Or what about when your dad's new girlfriend decides that she wants to take the convertible to school and keep the top down because it's such a nice day, and she decides to put her hair in a ponytail, and I just learned how to wrap my hair, so I'm wearing it down, and then like the wind is blowing, and then I get to school, and I look like Doc Brown from Back to the Future. I am worried, okay? I am full of worry. Okay, also on the list of things, I'm sorry, I got like super emotional. Also on the long list of things that you are not supposed to do when you have a relaxer is dye your hair at home. I did not get this memo. And so my best friend Melissa, you know, she decided that she wanted to dye her hair because apparently for white girls, dyeing your hair like rebellious shades of colors is like kind of like a rite of passage. And so she kind of roped me into it because, you know, solidarity is for white women. So I was like, all right, girl, I'm with you. And so she's gonna dye her hair like bright red. And I'm like, all right, I'll throw some like streaks in my bangs. And I'll just like keep it cool. I didn't know that you had to actually bleach your hair first, so the red didn't actually show up. It was more like a dark purple, which was great for me because I looked cool to Melissa, my mom didn't know that I dyed my hair, and it was awesome, right? Win-win. It was a win-win until I went to go get my relaxer touched up. So I was going to one of those like kitchen salons. It was a dark kitchen, it was a very dark kitchen. And so, my hairdresser did not know that I had dyed my hair because it was very dark and couldn't really see it, and her apartment was also very dark. So I'm sitting there, and I've got the stuff on my hair, and people are like, this is the horror movie, make this movie. This is like freaking terrifying. Like, yeah, it was horrible. So like the relaxer and the hair color like going to war in my head, like you relax, no you relax, no you relax. And then I can't relax because my hair is like falling out in clumps. And my hairdresser is like, what did you do? What's going on? What's happening here? And she's picking up like these like shiny-ish purple looking clumps of hair. And I literally snatched my own edges. Like, I now had like a bald spot on like either side of my head, and I didn't even have enough bangs left to cover it up. It was that bad. And like any mature young adult, I confided in / blamed Melissa, because why the f*** did she do this to me? I knew I shouldn't have trusted her after I asked her to do my makeup and she put white foundation on me. I should have known not to ask her to help me with my hair. Oh, God. Here's the thing. Melissa actually turned out to be incredibly resourceful. Not only was she really good at doing like crazy hair colors and like sneaking out at night and like doing coke or whatever else she was doing. Melissa was freaking wild. Like everyone had that friend. That was my friend. Melissa was like, listen, I have the perfect solution. Maybelline Great Lash Mascara. No, listen, you take the brush and the brush makes it look like you've got baby hairs. I didn't even have baby hairs before I snatched my edges, and now I did. Like, it was amazing. I went from Naomi Campbell at the beach to Chili from TLC in like a minute. It was like amazing. And then I had that one moment of like, oh, but what if it rains? And Melissa's like, that's why there's waterproof. The end. Thank you.
Amazing.
Good night.
Yeah, you gotta love it.
She has a million followers. Francesca, like us, tag us. We're fans. Hey.
Well, you've probably never said, hey, guess what I saw at the Micro Cinema last night? Now, that's a film screening for a small audience, say 20 to 50 people, and our next guests are working hard to find a permanent home in Bed-Stuy for their Micro Cinema called the Luminal Theater. The venue may be modest, but the idea behind it is quite big.
Oh, yes, it is. So is the ambition. Here's how the Luminal describes its mission. Quote, while open to all cultures and film types, the primary mission of the Luminal is to provide fully curated exhibitions of diverse cinema and media of the African diaspora. Going forward, it will be an arts facility to serve this underserved community, as similar spaces do not cater to their audiences, unquote. Now, here to tell us how they hope to reach that goal are the Luminal Executive Director, Curtis Caesar. John, welcome back to BK Live, sir.
Thank you.
And we also want to welcome its Artistic Director, Clarissa Clay.
Yes. Thank
welcome.
You. Thank you. Thank
so,
you both.
Brooklynites, you know, you both, you know, welcome to BK Live. It's such an honor to have you here. Now, the idea of a micro cinema, can you please tell us, first and foremost, what is a micro cinema?
Well, it's really just having an intimate space in order to view films that you might not have ever gotten a chance to see. A lot of the films that we would show there that are shown at various micro cinemas are stuff that's been on festival runs, but you know, might not have been in big theaters or might have only been in theaters for a week or something along those lines. And it's really just expanding the life of your film in different ways and also providing a space for the audience, for different audiences to really see those type of films. You know, it's people don't always have access to them. And you would think now with all the digital technology that exists with the Netflix and Hulu and all that, that they would, but you know, people are very distracted by all these things, you know? So it's like having that home, that space for people to come and view it and for it to be, you know, as we say, fully curated is, you know, a very important thing.
So Ms. Artistic Director over here, who are you curating for? Are you trying to get your cousins in, or you want the like highfalutin folks who want to only see serious films to come? Who are you curating for, and how do you reach out?
Oh, all of the above.
Gotcha.
We did for my neighborhood church in Bed-Stuy. We had like a private screening, and it was just so wonderful.
Yeah.
They came there; they never had that kind of experience. And then we had a Q&A, and it was like, "Wait a minute, my voice matter? Yes, your voice matter. We want to hear what you have to say about this film." Mm-hmm. And that was a great experience. And then we have the purists like, "Yes, right. Are you showing documentaries? Yes, are you showing shorts? Yes." So we get from that range to this range, yeah.
So how did we sort of get here? Can you tell us, you know, where the idea sort of came into fruition, how you were able to, you know, aggregate support, and tell us about your pop-up theater experiences?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, as far as getting there, like, you know, we've both worked at film festivals as festival directors, creative directors, and
programmers,
yeah, filmmakers, yeah,
great resumes.
Yes.
But along with that, it's like, you know, working in that field, working in providing exhibitions for different types of films and filmmakers, really just find that there's hard to find a space to like really show your work on a consistent basis, mm-hmm. you know? So it's like, so when I first devised that idea, I was like, okay, let's try and find a home, especially for like black films. Because the unfortunate thing, the unfortunate reality really is that, you know, a lot of programmers are not seeking out these films. And these films, I mean, they're just excellent films. They're not excellent films because they're made by black filmmakers. They're excellent films because they're excellent films. So to have a venue for that, or for even for like first-time filmmakers be able to show their stuff is just key to really not only understanding how your film plays in front of an audience, but understanding how the film plays in front of, you know, audience that a lot of times the community who you made the film for. And a lot of times it's, you know, just be honest, black people make films for everybody, but, you know, with a black audience in mind, because that's where they're from. Right. So that's how it really came about. And I thought of the idea, and I thought Clarissa would be a great partner for it, so I asked her to join in. Thankfully, she gladly did. And that was really it, you know, as far as the devising of it. And to expand that, it's just like, as far as having the pop-up space, it was really fantastic. We only had it for 3 months, unfortunately. It was during the summertime out in Bed-Stuy. But it was a fantastic experience, just really connecting with the community and knowing that this is something that I actually really did want. Yeah. You know, we felt that they would and that they did, but
It was really nice to see directors respond to the community watching their films. They felt like, this is who I wanted to target.
Missing piece.
Yes, exactly. And to have the reaction, and they're sitting there saying, this is who I made the film for, and here they are sitting in front of me, and we're interacting together. That was like a fabulous experience. It was overwhelming sometimes. Yeah.
So for folks who aren't a part of your church family, where do you go to see the films? And I know you guys, like every third arts organization, is looking for a home.
Yes. We go to festivals. We go to premieres. It's just our network that we have with filmmakers, actors, directors, all kinds of people. And they'll ask us to come and see their film and something like that.
But also submissions.
Yeah.
I mean, we put out a call for submissions and say, you know, we are here, you know, we want to show your films, and we got a good number of them and found some really fantastic new filmmakers through that process as well. So that's an important aspect of it. We had a filmmaker drive out from Ohio just to show his film.
Yeah.
Okay, can you tell us a little bit about Sty Talks?
Yeah,
absolutely. Well, Sty Talks is a discussion series that we're putting together. It's hopefully will be launching sometime in the spring. And it's really just about connecting with Bed-Stuy filmmakers and artists and letting the community know about who they are and what their work is. So in a lot of ways, it'll be kind of be like, if you've ever seen like Inside the Actors Studio, it'll be a bit like that, kind of like intersection between that and like a TED Talk.
Talks with
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you got it.
Yeah.
But it's really about, because, you know, Bed-Stuy is a huge enclave of filmmakers and artists, always has been a huge enclave of artists for many, many years. But, you know, we found, especially when doing the micro cinema, with doing the pop-up, that there's sometimes a bit of a disconnect between the artists and the community. Not intentional, but it's just, you know, everyone's busy. This is New York, this is Brooklyn. And we just don't always know who's doing what. So Sty Talks is really about connecting that intersection. It's about making sure everybody knows who's doing what.
Okay.
And if anybody out there has a space for lease at a great price, are you ready to put down some stakes and move in and put a ring on it in Brooklyn?
Yes.
Or we will be soon.
Okay.
We will be soon. They should definitely contact us about that.
And you can contact us through our website, www.luminaltheater.org.
Very cool.
All right.
Luminal Theater Dial. All right, so we're going to let you go now, but tell us what's up next. What film can Aaron and I drop in and see, and where can we find you?
Go ahead.
We have, like you said, the pop-up space doesn't exist right now, so we're looking for that permanent space.
Okay.
So the next thing will be Sty Talks. Mm-hmm. So they can definitely look for us there. We don't have an announcement to make about that yet, but hopefully we will extremely soon.
This is where people come to announce
things. Yeah.
But the thing is, we're working towards having a capital campaign for for the actual permanent space. Between doing a discussion series and doing a few film events, and then, you know, working on fundraising, you know, that's what we're focusing on right now. People go right to the website and support us.
All right.
In that.
And that we'll
definitely
we'll see
support.
You back here.
Exactly.
Yeah. There we go.
And the creators keep creating.
Yes.
So yes.
Much.
Keep creating and submit. Yes. All right. Well, thank you very much. Well, up next, how Central Brooklyn will be honoring the memory and the legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. But right now, from a live concert in our Brick Ballroom, here's a band named for another great African-American leader a century earlier. Here is Harriet Tubman featuring the brilliant Cassandra Wilson.
Writing is on the wall. The rainbow is on my steps. I promised myself that I would only listen to the voice that gives me breath. My freedom is all I have. My freedom is all I own. You can't control. Take to the streets. They offer their souls. They will not stop until the guns have been thrown away. We will not stop until the story unfolds. Freedom is all we have.
All right, the incomparable Cassandra Wilson. Well, moving on, Monday the 18th is, of course, Martin Luther King Day. It's also Family Day for the Central Brooklyn Martin Luther King Commission, as well as for hundreds of kids and their families who've participated in this year's MLK Poetry, Art, and Essay Competition to be held at the Prospect Heights High School near the Brooklyn Museum. The competition was started 31 years ago by Major Owens, a former librarian and housing activist who, of course, was elected to Congress from Central Brooklyn. Now, back then, there was no federal holiday commemorating Dr. King, and Major Owens was out to change that.
Well, over its 31 years, the contest has brought out thousands of poems, essays, and works of art dedicated to Dr. King, and a lot of prizes and recognition to contest participants and winners. Recently, themes related to Dr. King have been shifting towards police brutality, school bullying, and prejudice towards the Muslim community. Joining us today by Skype is Commission Member and State Assemblyman Walter Mosley. Nice to see you again, Assemblyman, even if it is from such a distance. And returning to our studio are Mitty Owens, son of the late Congressman. Welcome back to BK Live.
Thank you.
And Justin Manning, a former contest winner who is now the treasurer of the CBMLK Commission. And thank you for joining us today, Justin.
Thanks for having us.
So your dad was a lion, and he was in America's governing body before MLK had the commemoration and the full recognition that was so rightly deserved. Do you have any idea what that push was like? We only have like Stevie Wonder in our mind that comes up every year. But what was the nuts and bolts of actually making that happen as a national holiday?
Well, I think my father and the Congressional Black Caucus deserve a great deal of credit, as well as the thousands of activists around the country who have been committed to keeping Dr. King's meaning and his legacy alive, and recognizing that no person in this country deserves a holiday more than Martin Luther King. So it's fantastic that we have it. Now the question is how we use it in the best way possible. It's wonderful to have a day off from school and from work, but it's even more wonderful to ensure that we're using that day to really educate, agitate, and inspire the meaning of Dr. King going forward.
Okay. So would you like to add, please?
Absolutely. Martin Luther King Jr., this is the man who graduated from Morehouse College at the age of 15, organized the bus boycotts, named Times Magazine Person of the Year, given Nobel Peace Prize. I think he was also mentioned as the first person on the Western world to advocate for nonviolence and be successful with that. So there is success in being young and being active. And that's how I see Martin Luther King's legacy. I think that's how we can continue to do that in our local and national community.
Now, as a former contest winner, and I'm not going to ask you how long ago you won that contest.
Thank you very much.
You're more welcome. But how do you feel that the legacy of Martin Luther King has sort of morphed in the eyes of the youth?
Absolutely. So like I said before, at the age of 15, he graduated from Morehouse College and then got started. Morehouse, oh, that's awesome. I went to Hampton, so you're good with me. Congressman Owens was a Morehouse man. So you see how this works. A graduate of HBCU, he was, of course, a preacher, but he was always a man that was for civil rights. And one thing about the civil rights movement, and as we're seeing now with the Black Lives Matter movement, is that this is mostly powered by the youth. Yeah. And this started before Martin Luther King, but he was the front, he was the front man for that. So when we look at those that are advocates, when we look at what's happening now, Martin Luther King's way of dealing with nonviolence and dealing with what we're dealing with our society, he's somebody that we look out for.
So Assemblymember Mosley, we all recognize that we're standing on his shoulders, but you're the only one who's doing it from the State House. So we're going to ask you, where is the fight now? If Dr. King were here today, where would he be devoting his energies, you think?
I think it would be his energies to off to his advocating those in need us to advocate the House while this man. Okay. We have a lot of work in terms of lessening the wage disparity, making sure that our young men and women who are homeless find a home, making sure that women and the feminization of poverty comes to cease, and ensuring that people have the ability to have some form of upward mobility as they proceed with their daily activities of going to work and finding an occupation and a career in an effort to live out the American dream. So I think Dr. King's legacy, I think, is really germane to what we're doing, whether it's trying to raise our minimum wage or whether or not we're trying to deal with the issue of income disparity or poverty that's ravaging our state. So I think Dr. King's message would be very relevant even in 2016.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, can you tell us a little bit about the contest? How many students actually participate in this endeavor?
Well, we have been committed every year to increasing the number substantially, and we're very proud of the fact that we've doubled the participants from last year. So we have nearly 500 participants this year, which is great, and we really want to thank our teachers in particular and our schools for really helping to get the word out and encouraging the students, because we know how much teachers have to deal with in the classroom. This is an extra thing, but at the same time, I think they recognize that it's something which helps their students to engage in a way which is kind of like a civics class, to think about Dr. King and his meaning on these different issues. So we have 450 students who participated this year. I was a judge this year, so I had a chance to really see firsthand the wonderful creative process that the students underwent in connecting King's message to these various issues. And we've been able to now have the submission occur online, so it's a much more technologically developed process. We have a whole panel of judges, of a wide array of backgrounds mm-hmm. who review both the essays, the poetry, and the art competition.
All right, Justin, you're the newest guy on the commission. Did you yes. get a chance to peep the submissions as well?
Yes, I did. I have an opportunity to do so. The submissions are submitted for art, poetry, as well as essays.
Yeah.
And what I realize is, as I work for a higher education institution, mm-hmm. is that writing is important and it starts early. And the next step towards writing is public speaking. Mm-hmm. So this is what we do the day of the essay contest, particularly with the poets and with the essayists. It's my job to prep these students to say, hey, what you did on paper is amazing. But can you go out there and challenge yourself to go to the next level? Yeah. Can you speak in front of folks? And you'll be surprised. We have elementary school, middle school, as well as high school participants. And it's the way that you carry yourself, and it's also a good way to prep yourself for what's coming up next, which is college. So this is that next step.
Okay, without revealing too much, can you give us maybe a little insight to how young people are connecting the legacy with some of the struggles that are very real that we're facing as we sit right here in Brooklyn now that maybe even surprised you?
Well, certainly for very young folks, we ask them just to reflect generally about Dr. King. Mm-hmm. But for the middle school and the upper school folks, for the high schoolers, we really pushed them this year to think about specific themes so that we move beyond simply Dr. King was a great man.
Right.
And it was, again, for them to think about the context of their lives, police brutality, immigration, the discrimination against Muslims, climate change, challenges around education, jobs, and economic justice, and it was really heartening to see how the young folks really stepped up and addressed those issues.
Yeah. Cool. Now, what are the prizes? Because kids are always motivated by prizes. There's some intrinsic value, of course, to the process. But what are the prizes that the kids are competing for?
Absolutely. Well, the first prize is the recognition, first of all. so that's the starting point. The recognition, and we make that very concrete by giving everyone a T-shirt and listing everyone who submits, because that's very important. Simply submitting, the act of achieving a piece of art or a poem or an essay, and it takes a lot of work. And I've worked with folks about that. So that's no small feat, just achieving that, completing it, and submitting it. But then beyond that, the prize winners get a modest cash prize, and we also have things that day where we actually raffle away a computer that day for folks who come, and we also have educational developments, sort of toys and games that we give away. But the cash prize is certainly for the top prize winners.
Well, that helps.
Cash is king.
To throw it back to you, Assemblymember, we know during Dr. King's era, there was a tension that is still familiar now of people working within the establishment and going in to change laws through Congress and pressing our electeds and folks who were in the street agitating. So I wondered, from your stance right now, how do you think folks who are sort of outside of the system and everyday folks who might be more inclined to use their bodies can help you to change votes and legislation to benefit folks who are here in Brooklyn?
Well, I think it was said when Mitty's noted that Dr. King was not some mythological figure. He was a human being, he was a man. And I think that if we start to understand that it's not just about the dream that Dr. King spoke about, but it's the life he led. As a man, as a father, as a preacher, as a civil rights activist. You know, Dr. King so noted in one of his speeches that, you know, integration is about the sharing of power, responsibility, and resources, how we do it in a very responsible way. And I think the key word is responsibility. I think a lot of us think that, you know, laws have been passed and they can never be undone, that policies can be pushed and they could never be undone. But as we've seen both nationally and locally, that's not the case. In fact, if we continue to not do nothing, we'll only go backwards. And I think that Dr. King would convey that to us if he was with us today. And if anything, we need to make sure that Dr. King's holiday is not a day off, but it's a time to reflect, but also to act upon in the spirit of Dr. King and the civil rights movement of the 50s and the 60s.
think we just got a little preview of someone's speech from MLK. And I just want to interject that we are very lucky to have elected representatives like Walter Mosley.
Absolutely.
Who else is on the bill?
And we've had a great deal of support from our local officials over the years. We generally have a very strong showing at the event. So it's very important for us at the city council level, the state assembly, and the state senate, Congress, to have support. So that's really great that we have people who understand the importance, the mission, and the meaning of Dr. King's life in terms of specific pieces of legislation mm-hmm. and the various issues that impact our lives.
You know, we were talking about Martin Luther King Day, but I do have to ask, you know, with the people that are participating and the students that are participating, how do you sort of make sure to keep Dr. King's legacy alive, you know, 365 days a year as well?
Well, that is the commission. It's a great opportunity for us to share that the commission is really looking at various ways that we can make sure the programming expands. Dr. King's mission is and vision is a lot of things. Number one, it's about ensuring we have quality education in our schools and working with our schools in a partnership. And so one of the new programs we've been developing is around college prep. So ensuring that our students have a elementary and middle school and high school pipeline to college and not the school to prison pipeline that we see all too often. So that's one piece of it. But in terms of the broader message of Dr. King, there are various ways that we're looking at how we can make sure that people understand that full meaning, the nonviolence, education, civil rights, the linkage to economic justice, the understanding of the importance of putting money for our country into the investing in our communities and our young people, rather than some of the other ways in which we divert our funds.
I'm the chair of the Public Relations Committee. And one of the new ways that we're doing this, which is keeping the legacy alive after Congressman Major Owens, is understanding that the legacy of Martin Luther King and Major Owens is for the community. So it takes community
work. That's where we're going to have to leave it, in the community. Thank you so much. We appreciate you coming in.
Thank you.
Tomorrow
on
BK Live, Jared Murphy of City Limits will lead a discussion on where Brooklyn stands on the battle over guns, a battle that involves gun violence, gun control, and now gun courts.
Well, this is a topic, of course, that has profound impact on individuals, families, and neighborhoods. And tomorrow we present the first of a three-part profile on Marlon Peterson, who was once in prison and yet is now a leader in his community's struggle to end gun violence.
And then a community of filmmakers is the subject of a video we'll also show you tomorrow. Young writers, directors, and producers help each other by crewing for each other and giving each other feedback. It's called Film Shop.
And it's awesome. And Michael Bellamy will address the subject of overzealous sports parents and whether or not our beleaguered Brooklyn Nets can stop themselves from spinning out of control.
Speaking of which, the spinning wheel is our current fireworks residency here at Brick. It's Bob Israel's tribute to his dad, Steve Ben Israel, a key figure in the New York counterculture theater scene of the 60s and 70s. We're going to get a behind-the-scenes look at this multimedia project and talk to Baba and his co-director right here.
All right. Well, have a great day, and thank you for watching. It's BK Live.